Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin, I'd like to enter into the record three letters and an op-ed supporting Judge Kavanaugh's confirmation. The first letter, which I mentioned yesterday in my opening statement, is a letter from 41 attorneys who are members of the Supreme Court Bar. The signers include people like Lisa Blatt, Deanne Maynard, and Kathleen Sullivan. As the letter notes, the signers, quote, hold a broad range of political, policy, and jurisprudential views, but they speak as one in supporting Judge Kavanaugh's nomination, unquote. The letter authors write, quote, based on our experience with Judge Kavanaugh and his work over 12 years of distinguished judicial service, we are confident that he possesses the character, temperament, and intellect that will make him an asset to our nation's highest court, unquote. Now, the second letter is from Carolyn Williams, a partner at the venerable D.C. law firm Williams & Connolly, who served on the ABA's Standing Committee on the Federal Judiciary. She writes that she has followed Judge Kavanaugh's legal career since 1990, when she was the hiring partner at the firm, and he was a law student. Ms. Williams says that Judge Kavanaugh, quote, has all the qualities litigants and lawyers hope to find in a Supreme Court justice, superb intellect and legal acumen, fundamental fairness and decency, abiding respect for precedent and the rule of law, unquote. Now, I also want to enter to the record a letter and op-ed by Jay Lefkowitz. The op-ed appeared in National Review and is entitled, Brett Kavanaugh is a Mensch. In it, Mr. Lefkowitz writes that Judge Kavanaugh, quote, has a strong commitment to protecting Americans' freedom of religion, no matter what their faith, unquote. And Mr. Lefkowitz should know, he and Judge Kavanaugh worked together in private practice on a pro bono religious freedom case representing a Jewish synagogue in Maryland. And they won the case, vindicating the right of the congregation to build a place of worship in their neighborhood. Okay. Now, let me just begin with this. Before I begin, Judge, I'd like to ask you to keep your answers to my questions as concise as you can so I can get through as many of them as time allows. Some of my colleagues have suggested that President Trump nominated you because he thought you'd rule in his favor should certain issues come before the court. Suppose you had a case involving President Trump or an issue near and dear to the president. What assurances can you provide that you will not allow the president's personal views on a case or personal interest to impact your decision?
Senator, I'm an independent judge. For 12 years, I've been deciding cases based on the law and the precedent in each case. If confirmed to the Supreme Court, that's how I'll do it as well. I'll be part of a team of nine. I'll decide cases based on the Constitution, the law, the precedent, the Supreme Court, working with that, the other eight justices, without fear or favor, independently, without pressure from any quarter. The person who has the best arguments on the law and the precedent is the person who will win in with me.
Well, thank you. If at the end of the process, at this process, you are confirmed to the Supreme Court, which I expect you will be, what sort of loyalty will you owe to the president? How will that loyalty differ from the loyalty you owe to, say, the American people?
Senator, if confirmed to the Supreme Court and as a sitting judge, I owe my loyalty to the Constitution. That's what I owe loyalty to. And the Constitution establishes me as an independent judge, bound to follow the law as written, the precedents of the Supreme Court as articulated, subject to the rules of stare decisis, and I would do so.
Okay, you were appointed to the D.C. Circuit by George W. Bush. I think it's fair to say you were close to President Bush. You worked for him for a number of years. Can you give us some example of cases in which you ruled against the Bush administration, notwithstanding that President Bush was the one who put you on the bench?
Senator, the most prominent example is the Hamdan case.
Yeah.
That was the military commission's case. That was a signature prosecution of the Bush administration. They had established, with congressional authorization eventually, after a unilateral effort didn't succeed in the courts, established military commissions. The military commissions were to try al-Qaeda terrorists who had committed war crimes. And one case came to us, Salim Hamdan, and the question was the prosecution unlawful because the crime of which he was convicted was not an identified crime as of 2001 when he was alleged to have committed it, ex post facto principles. And I wrote the opinion reversing his conviction, even though it was a signature prosecution of the United States, even though it was a national security case, because that was the right answer under the law, and it doesn't matter who you are or where you come from, if you're right under the law, you prevail.
I'd like to turn now to your work in the Bush administration. As you know, my Democratic colleagues are demanding to see every piece of paper or every single scrap of paper you ever touched during your 6 years in the Bush administration, in part because they want to know what role, if any, you played in developing the Bush administration's interrogation policies. Well, 6 years ago, Ranking Member Feinstein, who was then the chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, and a good one at that, issued a lengthy report on the CIA's detention and interrogation program under President Bush. The report detailed the origins, development, and implementation of the program. In 2014, a declassified version of that report was released to the public. The declassified version, or report, runs well over 500 pages, and your name appears nowhere in it. Now, I myself spent over 20 years on the Intelligence Committee. I know the quality of its staff and the work that they do, and I know the ranking member and how diligent she is. If you had played a role in the Bush administration's interrogation policies, I think the ranking member would have discovered it. Numerous administration lawyers appear in the report, but not you. And that should tell us something. With that said, Judge Kavanaugh, I want to ask you for the record, what role, if any, did you play in developing or implementing the Bush administration's detention and interrogation policies?
Well, the policies that are reflected and described in Senator Feinstein's extensive, thorough report were very controversial, as you know, Senator. The enhanced interrogation techniques and the legal memos that were involved in justifying some of those techniques also were very controversial when they were disclosed in 2004. And I was not involved, I was not read into that program, not involved in crafting that program, nor crafting the legal justifications for that program. In addition to Senator Feinstein's report, the Justice Department did a lengthy Office of Professional Responsibility report about the legal memos that had been involved to justify some of those programs. My name's not in that report, Senator, because I was not read into that program and not involved. There were a number of lawyers, and this came up at my last hearing, a number of lawyers who were involved, including a couple who were then judicial nominees. And at my last hearing, I recall Senator Durbin asking about whether I also was likewise involved as these other judicial nominees had been. And the answer was no, and that answer was accurate. And that answer has been shown to be accurate by the Office of Professional Responsibility report, by Senator Feinstein's thorough report. And I do want to say on Senator Feinstein's report, that is an important piece of work that collected facts about a program, that it's important for us to know those facts for the future. And I know it was an enormous effort and a lot of tough work to get all that information for Senator Feinstein and the Intelligence Committee. But I have looked through that report and looked through the Office of Professional Responsibility report. I was not read into that program, Senator. Thank you for asking.
Okay. Judge, you've been accused of misleading this committee during your 2006 confirmation hearing regarding your role in developing the Bush administration detention policy. Now, you have a strong reputation in the legal community for honesty and integrity. Read any one of the dozens of letters we received supporting your nomination, and you'll see that right away. Now, some of my colleagues may not give you the opportunity to answer this question fully, so I'd like to give you the opportunity now. Did you mislead this committee in 2006? If not, what is the source of the confusion about your prior testimony?
I told the truth and the whole truth in my prior testimony. I was not read into that program. The subsequent reports of Senator Feinstein and Office of Professional Responsibility show that. And that is what I did then. That's the answer now. I was not read into that program.
Okay, as I mentioned in my opening statement, 18 of your former women law clerks have written to the committee in support of your nomination. That's all of your former women law clerks who were not precluded by their current or pending employment from signing the letter. Now, these women describe the mentoring and encouragement you've given them in their careers. And they say that you are, quote, one of the strongest advocates in the federal judiciary for women lawyers, unquote. Quite a compliment. The majority of your clerks, in fact, have been women. Now, I understand that you were the first judge in the history of the D.C. Circuit to have an all-female class of clerks. Why do you believe it important to encourage young women lawyers and to ensure that both men and women are well represented in the legal profession?
Senator, I believe in equality. Equality for all Americans, men and women, also regardless of race, ethnicity. My mom was an example, as I described yesterday, of breaking barriers, showing me first on racial equality by her example of teaching at McKinley Tech. Then, when she became a lawyer in the late 70s, there were not many women prosecutors at the time, definitely male-dominated. And how she overcame barriers, was a great prosecutor, became a state trial judge in Maryland, appointed by Democratic governors. She showed me by her example the importance of women's equality. During college, you've received a letter from 10 college friends of mine who are women athletes at Yale, talked about how I treated them and women's sports with respect and as equal. Even when I was in college. You have a letter from 84 women I worked with in the Bush administration who talked about my efforts to work with them in the tense environment of the West Wing, especially after September 11th.
Did you say 84?
84 women signed a letter who had worked in the Bush White House, and worked in that tense environment. But I came to be a judge in May 2006, and August 2006, Linda Greenhouse of the New York Times runs a story in the New York Times about the scarcity of women law clerks at the Supreme Court that year. There were 7, I believe, that year out of 37, and she wrote a story about that. And that seemed to me very odd and unacceptable. And I started thinking about what I could do. First of all, why is that happening, and what can I do about it? What's the problem? What can I do? So the problem seemed to me these networks that people, judges, rely on for clerk hiring, some professor networks, were excluding women, or at least women weren't fully represented in those. That's true with minorities as well, by the way. And so I made sure when I was talking to professors at law schools that I made sure I want to see a broad pool of qualified, well-qualified applicants, including women. And in that year, for example, fall of 2006, which was my first year on the bench, we hire a year ahead, so I'm hiring for 2007. And I hired three women for that clerk class 2007, three out of the four. Zena Bash, Britt Grant, and Porter Wilkinson. Zena's right here. That was the start of my efforts to make sure that women were not being excluded. And I really worked on why is this happening. So Yale Law Women did a study about 5 years ago about participation in class, the differences on who gets called on in class, and there's slight differences there, men and women, who then get selected as research assistants, slight differences there, and it just keeps building till you get a disparity in the clerk network. And there's a pipeline problem, and I've said I'm breaking through that problem. I'm not listening to that. And so I've been very aggressive about hiring the best and understanding that the best include women. And as you say, Senator, a majority of my clerks have been women, 25. I believe 21 of them have gone on to clerk at the Supreme Court. And they're an awesome group. And if confirmed to the Supreme Court, I will continue to do this. What it takes, and I think my mom showed me this, President Bush showed me this a little, what it takes is just not accepting the same old answer. Oh, there's a disparity. Well, why? And then do something about it. And I tried to figure out why, and we can talk about minority clerks too, but on women, why? Where those disparities existing, as described by Linda Greenhouse. And I tried to figure out why, and then I did something about it. I'm very proud of that, because I do believe that all people should be treated equally. And the law clerk position, which may sound ministerial, and to some extent the job is helping the judge and shortly out of law school, but those positions are very important launching pads for the next generation of leaders. The people will be sitting in these seats. The people will be sitting in my seat. Lots of them are going to come from law clerks. So if we're not being inclusive now, that will show up later. And so it's just been a critical part. It's something I'm very focused on at all times, is equality in the clerkship hiring process and making sure women are getting the same opportunities that men are. I appreciate the question, Senator.
Well, thank you, and I appreciate the answer. And I think everybody in this country should appreciate the answer. And I think it distinguishes you. Late last year, allegations against former Ninth Circuit Judge Alex Kaczynski surfaced when the Washington Post published an article detailing disturbing allegations of misconduct by the judge. You clerked for Judge Kaczynski for 1 year in 1991-1992. Some of your opponents have suggested that you must have known about these allegations. This seems to me to be an effort at guilt by association, which is not the way this committee should operate in any way. With that in mind, I want to give you a chance to answer a few questions about Judge Kaczynski so that we're all operating on the same foundation of facts. First, how long have you known Judge Kaczynski?
I clerked for him in 1991-92, so I started the clerkship 27 years ago.
Second, I understand from media reports that Judge Kaczynski operated an email list where he would send inappropriate material. Were you on this email list?
I don't remember anything like that, Senator.
How often did you talk with Judge Kaczynski on the phone?
Not often. Not often, Senator.
How often did you see him in person?
Again, not often. Maybe when there was a legal convention or...
That's what a lot of people don't seem to understand, you know.
I was not working in the courthouse. He was in the Pasadena courthouse in California with a small courthouse with 10 other Court of Appeals judges in that courthouse. I, of course, was working in Washington, D.C.
When you did see and talk with Judge Kaczynski, what type of things did you talk about?
We were among the 12 co-authors of the Brian Garner-led book on judicial precedent. So for several years, that was a project. All of us were, the 12 of us, I guess it was in total, were working on that. Diane Wood, Chief Judge of the Seventh Circuit, and
right.
And Justice Gorsuch was also a co-author, so we worked on that as a group. And then Justice Kennedy, for the last 30 years, had Judge Kaczynski run Justice Kennedy's law clerk hiring process. And in the course of that process, I would have communications with the judge.
Okay. Did you know anything about these allegations?
Nothing.
Okay. Before they became public last year?
No. When they became public, the first thought I had was no woman should be subjected to sexual harassment in the workplace, ever, including in the judiciary, especially in the judiciary. And when I heard, when they became public, I think it was in December, it was a gut punch. It was a gut punch for me.
It was for me, too.
It was a gut punch for the judiciary. And I was shocked and disappointed, angry, swirl of emotions. No woman should be subjected to sexual harassment in the workplace. And I applaud Chief Justice Roberts' appointed committee of judges to establish better procedures. Chief Judge Garland did the same thing for our court. And those are first steps. I don't think they're final steps by any stretch. And this is part of a much, much larger national problem of abuse and harassment. And one of the things we've learned is we need better reporting mechanisms. Women, in particular in the workplace, need to know if they're the victim of harassment, where to report it immediately, who to report it to. They need to be know that they'll be safe if they report it. They need to have a safe working environment and be safe if they report it. They won't be retaliated against, and they'll be protected if they report it. And that's part of the steps, or one of the steps that's, I think, being improved as a result of the working group or committee that the Chief Justice has appointed. And I'm interested in doing everything I can to assist those efforts to make those workplaces safe. Again, it's part of a broader national problem, whether it's priests or teachers or coaches or doctors or business people or news people. There's a broad national problem that needs to be addressed, including in the judiciary, and
okay.
I applaud Chief Justice Roberts for doing so.
Okay, I'd like to talk to you now about the Chevron doctrine. Now, this is an important judicial doctrine that takes its name from the Supreme Court case that created it back in the 1980s. In that case, the Supreme Court instructed federal courts to defer an agency's interpretation of the law if the law is, quote, ambiguous, unquote. Some of your academic writings express skepticism about the Chevron doctrine and concern that it allows an administration to impose its policy preference by avoiding the political process. I can understand why this would be appealing to an administration, but I also think it's a threat to the separation of powers because it transfers power from Congress and the judiciary to the executive branch. That's why I've introduced the Separation of Powers Restoration Act to reverse the Chevron doctrine. Many members of this committee have co-sponsored this legislation. And as someone who has written extensively about the separation of powers, can you tell us why the separation of powers is so important and how it helps to protect individual freedom?
The separation of powers protects individual liberty because it responds to the concern the framers had, that something Senator Klobuchar said yesterday from Federalist 47, that the accumulation of all power in one body would be the very definition of tyranny. So Federalist 47 talks about that, Federalist 69. So the separation of powers, to begin with, protects individual liberty. It does so because Congress can pass the laws, but you can't enforce the laws. A separate body has to decide to enforce the laws. And then even if the law is enforced and a citizen may say, Well, I want someone who didn't pass the law or enforce it to decide whether I violated the law or whether the law is constitutional. And that's why we have an independent judiciary, to guarantee, as an independent matter, our rights and liberties. And the three branches, therefore, do separate things because it all tilts toward liberty. It's hard to pass a law, as you know, in the Congress. And then, even if it does get passed and affects your liberty, a separate body has to decide, usually U.S. Attorney's Office, to enforce the law, and that's a separate decision. That helps protect your liberty. And then, even if that happens, you go to a court and you say, either I didn't violate that law, as I'm accused of doing, or that law is unconstitutional, or they're interpreting that law in a way that's not consistent with what the law said. The court independently decides that. It's not the members of Congress or the executive deciding that. That's how the Constitution's separation of powers tilts toward liberty in all its respects. Now, as to your specific question, Senator, one of the things I've seen in my experience in the executive branch and in the judicial branch is a natural tendency, but it's a natural tendency that judges need to be aware of and then respond to. So here's the natural tendency. Congress passes laws, but then can't update the law. So maybe it's an environmental law, or maybe it's some kind of law dealing with national security. Let's take those two examples to illustrate. And then an executive branch agency wants to do some new policy and proposes a new policy to Congress, but Congress doesn't pass the new policy. What often happens, or too often I've seen, is that the executive branch then relies on the old law as a source of authority to do this new thing. And they try to say, well, the old law is ambiguous, so we can fit this new policy into the old law as justification for doing this new thing. And I've seen this in national security cases. I've seen it in environmental cases. You see it all over the place. It's a natural phenomenon because the executive branch wants to implement what it thinks is good policy. Now, when those cases come to court, it's our job to figure out whether the executive branch has acted within the authority given to it by Congress. Have you given them the authority? And my administrative law jurisprudence is rooted in respect for Congress. Have you passed the law to give the authority? I've heard it said that I'm a skeptic of regulation. I am not a skeptic of regulation at all. I am a skeptic of unauthorized regulation, of illegal regulation, of regulation that's outside the bounds of what the laws passed by Congress have said. And that is what is at the root of our administrative law jurisprudence.
Okay, one of the most important qualities I look for in a judicial nominee is the ability to impartially interpret the law and apply it to the case before the court. Now, this can often be the most difficult part of a judge's job because it may require the judge to rule against a litigant that may be sympathetic or against a policy that the judge may personally agree with. As Justice Sotomayor's confirmation hearings, Senator Schumer commended her for, quote, hewing carefully to the text of statutes, even when doing so results in rulings that go against so-called sympathetic litigants, unquote. Do you believe that it's important for a judge to interpret and apply the laws that Congress has actually passed rather than seeking to make up or change the law if the judge doesn't like what the Congress has done? And if so, why or why not?
I agree completely, Senator. That's at the foundation of what I view as the proper judicial philosophy.
Okay.
The separation of powers system you described, we have to stick to the laws passed by Congress. You make the policy. Will follow the policy direction that you put into the laws that are enacted, passed by the House and Senate, signed by the President. We don't rewrite those laws. The executive branch also shouldn't be rewriting those laws beyond the scope of the authority granted.
Okay. Some of my colleagues have criticized you for purportedly ruling too often against environmental interests. It seems to me that many of these circumstances boil down to the fact that some of my colleagues don't like the environmental laws Congress has actually passed and are frustrated that they haven't been able to get their own preferred environmental policy signed into law. Now, I've looked through your record, and I found that you have not hesitated at all to uphold environmental regulations when they were actually authorized by statute. Could you give us a few examples of cases where you have upheld environmental regulations because you concluded that Congress had authorized them?
Limited to as many few as you can as time has run out.
Senator, as I said yesterday, I'm a pro-law judge, and in environmental cases, in some cases I've ruled against environmentalist interests, and in many cases I've ruled for environmentalist interests, and they're big cases, cases like the American Trucking Association's case where I upheld a California regulation for a majority over a dissent, stricter air quality standards in the National Association of Manufacturers case, EPA rules for particulate matter in the UARG case, permit process applicable to surface coal mining in the National Mining Association case, the Murray Energy case rejecting a premature challenge to a clean power plan regulation, National Resources Defense Council case versus EPA, ruling for environmentalist groups in a case that was a big money case where the industry wanted an affirmative defense to be created for accidental emissions. The affirmative defense was not in the statutes passed by Congress. The industry came in with their lawyers and said, well, just write the affirmative defense into the law. And I wrote the opinion saying, no, it's not in the law. And yes, that might be a problem for industry, but we follow the law regardless. And so there are a large number of cases where I've ruled in favor of environmentalist interests because that's what the law required in that case.
Well, thank you, Judge. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Senator.
Senator Leahy.